Okay. If you want to take your attendance. Okay. First, before we start, I would like to announce that I will not giving you any more assignment. Okay, so the last assignment. Actually, the last for this class. Instead, I'll start to give you some foundation or theoretical base for your final exam. So your final exam will relate to information system analysis and design, part of our lecture, which is today and the next 2 weeks. Okay. Don't worry, it will be. Well, it won't be as advanced as the other classes, but I'll give you assignment that related to the material that we will explore starting today. Okay. And the real information system analysis will be. You will meet them in a specific course called Information System Analysis and Design. Okay, can't remember which semester. Especially next semester, we will have and use new curriculum. There will be shifting in the states where you should pick up or enroll into certain courses. And to be honest, I can't remember which when you should take that course, but it will be there. Okay. And don't worry about the new curriculum since you only on your second semester, it won't affect you as much. Unlike your seniors that probably closing to their thesis, they will have a lot of things to do, but not you. So just wait for that and enjoy whatever. Coming to you. Okay, now before we start, I promise you that we will discuss general ledger and reporting system. Okay, the last part that we haven't had time to touch last week. Okay, Stefania, can you see it at home?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good, thanks. Alan, you feel all right? Do you feel all right? Have you recover from your okay. What is it? Is it COVID? Okay, but you feel fine? No? Okay. Is it the mild or the severe one? I mean, what the symptoms that you felt? Did you have fever? Did you have fever? Okay. Glad you can join us today. Okay. So yeah, general ledger and reporting system. Okay. So with general ledger, this is the culmination or where all the information will go from all others transaction processing cycles. Information from revenue cycle will go to this part. Information from expenditure cycle will go to this part, and also from production and human resource. Most of them, you already encounter during your introduction to accounting courses, and you will, of course, encounter it even more during the all the financial accounting courses. Okay, so these are the four major activities for general ledger and reporting system. Update the general ledger based on the journal entries. Okay. In the old manual system, the journal entries will be posted to general ledger regularly. But with computerized system, as soon as the transaction finalized, the general ledger will be updated. So in theory, you can stop anytime and then create financial report on the spot, theoretically. But nobody ever did that, I think. They still, most company will have try to create financial report regularly rather than on the spot. Post adjusting entries, prepare financial statement, and that's concluding the financial accounting side of this part. And then produce managerial report. That would be for managerial accounting. Copy. So in managerial report, for example, you'll find information about somebody's performance. You'll find a report on did your division met the target or not? And what are the targets? It won't appear on any external financial statement. You probably will have in financial statements an entry called expenditure for bonuses and the total amount, but you probably will not find it how much accounting staff made, how much the accounting staff earned their bonuses, or how much the division chief had their bonuses. It's all information that will be produced for internal parties rather than external parties like financial statement. Now, what are the general threats during the general ledger reporting cycle? First, obviously, inaccurate or invalid general ledger data. However, there is a term called materiality in accounting. You probably will find it when you enroll into auditing courses. Okay. Materiality means something that has significant value. Okay. And it depends on the company, the size, the nature of the company, and so on and so forth. So for examples, a small convenience store near your home, 1 million for them probably have significant value. But for large company enterprises like Pertamina, 1 million rupiah is nothing. So as long as the inaccuracy stay well within the acceptable limit, the materiality, you can say that the information are accurate. So any discrepancies, as long as it's still within the materiality limit, it won't matter. In the past, I've seen a report from one of the big four accounting firms that sometimes they found that the discrepancy in cash for their clients amount up to 100 million rupiah per day. And yet for that company, it's deemed as immaterial. 100 million is just, you know, a small change for them. So discrepancy up to 100 million rupiah will be ignored. But for other businesses, 100 million rupiah probably get whole value. So it depends on the company, the size, the operation, and so on and so forth. But you need to remember that. So accuracy could not be 100%. That's what I'm trying to say. Okay. For updating general ledger, there are inaccuracy of updating general ledger or unauthorized journal entry. That's why we need to keep what it calls as an audit trail. Okay. Audit trail means all the evidence created while you process a transaction. Say, for example, sales. Starting from the order from customers, the order, the sales order or purchase order from customer will be the first evidence of a sales. And then you create or produce invoice, you produce a picking ticket to get the products that ordered by customer from warehouse, you get delivery report, you get receiving report from the customer, you get the invoice to bill the customer, and you get a payment from customer. All of those activities will create a trail of documents as evidence of a transaction. So with audit trail, it's called audit trail because it's usually being examined during audit process. So in audit, for example, you can track a transaction with all the evidence up to the financial statement. So if, say, you found an evidence of sales of a product valued 100 million rupiah, you can track all the documentation from the order, the invoice, the delivery report, the receiving report, the payment from customer, and then the journal for it. Post of that journal into general ledger, and then from general ledger to the financial report. All the evidence are there for you to trail. Or you can trace back from financial report or financial statement to the specific transaction. For example, you see that they made 1 billion sales in a year. You can pick up any date and try to find evidence of sales in that particular date up to the purchase order from specific customer. Okay. So that's audit trail. The problem with audit, the modern audit trail, is because it's digital. Okay. So for example, if you want to buy or you want to pay, for example, you want to buy electricity token from a marketplace. You order our electricity token, you select the amount, and you pay for it. Okay. All done digitally. And the problem with digital file, it's easily being manipulated. And for the layman eyes like us, it's very difficult to differentiate between original, genuine digital document and manipulated digital document or edited digital document. Okay. Let me give you these examples. Suppose you have a file in your iPad or in your mobile phone. The answer to your assignment, for example, or your submission to assignments. And one of your friends came up and, can I copy it? And he or she make the copy and put it on their own device. Can you differentiate between those two files, which one is genuine and which one is the copy? It's very difficult. Although with the proper tools and technique, there are actually differences between the original and the copy. You just need to look at certain what they call metadata using specific tools. That's why auditors, especially that dealing with digitalized information system, will use these tools to verify the validity and the whether or not the digital document that they examine are genuine. Okay. Just ping entries. I will not go to this in details. Okay. I think you are better than me in this part because for me, this is like 30 years ago. Okay. And one thing, that the main differences between your time and my time was this part. When I was learning about accounting 20 years ago, revaluation is some practice that frowned upon accounting community. Accounting community at the time believed in historical costs. So whatever the book said, the value of an asset, that's the one being trusted. Okay. So if I bought a car and it has been 3 years, the value of that car would be the cost of that car minus all the depreciation for 3 years. However, in the last few years, especially after the international accounting standard being implemented in Indonesia, revaluation become a norm. Even some, I can't really remember whether this is true, but the accounting standard require company to make routine revaluation of their asset to adjust for market price changes. So for example, if my car is actually more expensive than the book value, then it should be revaluated according to the market price or market value. But again, this is not something that can be done easily. There should be third independent party to make the valuation. That's why nowadays there are a profession that calls the asset valuation professionals. They actually have schools and certification for this. Few of my former students and former staff already take the courses and certified for this kind of job. And they work for a valuation company. And you need to be careful with revaluation because it can be done to facilitate fraud, especially financial reporting fraud, okay, by either overvaluing asset or undervaluing asset. But that's the problem for auditing process, not mine. Okay, again, adjusting entries, there will be inaccuracy or unauthorized adjusting entries. That's why all the documents should be in proper form, and it has to be signed by proper authority. Inaccurate financial statement, again, as long as it's within limit, this discrepancy can be ignored. However, number two is different. Fraudulent financial reporting was created with the intention to fool the users, to defraud the users, or intentionally trying to commit crime. Okay, that's in it. Third, it has nothing to do with accuracy or fraudulent, but it's the poorly designed report and grants. If you look at the actual financial report from any company, you'll find that they have been prepared using fancy colors, fancy papers, you know, interesting graphics, nice colors to emphasize important information, okay, and so on and so on. That's why poorly designed reporting graphs could disrupt the information that the company tried to convey to the users. Okay. So if you, for example, if you want to show that the company has been growing for the last 5 years, the wrong graphics can lead the readers not to believe the information. Okay. That's why visualization, how to visualize information, become a very important part of this type of reporting. And luckily, one of my proposal for the new curriculum, which is elective for data analysis, business data analysis, has been approved. So there will be elective course that teach you how to analyze data and prepare proper report. I'm not talking about the art part or the graphical designing part of a report or information, because I'm not an expert in that. But for examples, if you want to show proportion, what kind of graph you should select? If you want to show growth, should you use pie chart or bar chart? And how to convey your message without being deceptive? In presenting or creating a financial report, there are some regulation that you need to follow. For example, the International Financial Reporting Standards, PSAK in Indonesia, that, well, basically Indonesian PSAK is the adoption of IFRS, so doesn't really matter in that part. And to be honest, I haven't really read any of the international financial reporting standards, the current standards, so I don't understand. Okay, so, but I'll leave it to you to deal with it. The next is extensible business reporting language. This is the new technology and has been compulsory usage in the US for all the public company. So what does it mean? You are familiar with a website, right? So a website is basically being built using a language called HTML. So XBRL, more or less, is the HTML, but for financial reporting. So this is a specific language for creating any financial report. What does it mean? It means the report will become in computer form readable. So a computer can look at the report, scan the report, and grab all the financial information automatically. For now, for example, if for your seniors that they write their thesis in financial report, financial accounting, and they're dealing with stock market, the only way they can extract information, financial information from financial report is to read the report one by one, and then get the number that they need, put the that number into Microsoft Excel table, for example, manually. But with XBRL, you can create a automatic task from Microsoft Excel, for example, to get, please get cash flow information from this company from years 2000 to 2022. And it will automatically grab only cash flow data from that report. That's what XBRL use. Now, managerial reports. This is for evaluating performance. There will be a base for responsibly accounting. It means within a company, there will be different division with different tasks, different responsibility. And each division will be evaluated based on their responsibility. So let me give you this example. Sales and production. Sales will be evaluated based on how much sales they can make in a year. Did they achieve their sales target? It means that how much revenue they can generate for the company. So revenue for sales. But you can't evaluate production division or production department using revenue because production department did not generate revenue. They create product, and creating product means they consume cost. So the evaluation for them should be how much cost they have spent for a year and compare it to the budget. Now, the budget is like you understand budget. Budget is just like a plan of financial plan for the whole year. How much revenue we will generate from where? How much cost we will expand for a year, where to, which part. Okay. Now, with the budget, the current trend is using flexible budget. It means you need to adjust the budget based on reality, because budget is a plan, and it was created a year ahead. And within a year, many things could happen. For example, in 2020, early in January 2020, who knows that we will head into a global lockdown in just a few months. Last week, just look at few of my application, and I realized I still went to movies. In the middle of March, I was still planning with my family to travel to Surabaya at the time. But then, after the announced lockdown, we canceled that plan. Okay. So, even for a week ahead, we don't know what would happen. Okay, anyway, let's apply to budget. And you will find this in managerial accounting subjects. Anyway, if you are not flexible with your budget, this is going to happen.
say you have sales vision and compassion vision.
The company aim or budget that they will sell 1,000 units. So the target for sales division would be to sell this 1,000 units. Production division, they have to produce this 1,000 unit with the target of cost, say, 1 rupiah each. So it would be 1,000 rupiah. That's budget. That's the initial plan. So, because of the great salesmanship from the sales department, they able to generate 1,200,000 unit of sales. So there are order from customer for 1,200 unit rather than only 1,000. So if you evaluate the performance of sales vision, what would be your evaluation? Good, bad, excellent, exceeding expectation? Obviously that was the case. But how about the production? They were targeted with 1,000 units. 1,000 rupiah. So this is the maximum cost they can consume during a year. However, since there were 1,200 unit for order, they need to create or produce 1,200 unit that will cost them 1,200 rupiah. So they exceeding the budget by 200. If you are not flexible with the budget, then you will punish the production division. Thus, they are way over their budget. 20% way over the budget, and 20% is quite high for any budget. But if you are not flexible with the budget for evaluating performance, then the production department will deny any request to produce more than 1,000. Why? Because that's the limit. If we produce more than 1,000, we will be punished because we are exceeding budget. Okay. And there are a lot of different methods of performance evaluation. One of them is the balance scorecard here to measure financial and non-financial performance. Again, it will be in the managerial accounting courses. That's for the general ledger and reporting system. Any question? Stefania, you have any question back at home?
Not yet, sir.
Okay. Okay, let's continue to introduction to system development and system analysis. This is my main area, either for teaching or research. Okay. I've been doing this since almost 25 years now, maybe more. I have been involved in developing application and systems for a few different organizations. Back in 2011, I was the project manager for a startup in Jogja at that time. It's photography related, and at that time, until about 2016, it was the biggest photography application in Southeast Asia. It's called photographer.net. We had more than 500,000 members, all verified with their identity, either KTP, driver license, or passport. So no fake account. We held like 2 million pictures, you know, on our systems, and it's very, very selective pictures, because members could only upload one per day. And it will be evaluated by others. Like if they give them 3 thumbs up, the highest mark, for example, why? And daily they will have the best pictures and the best pictures and the best pictures and sorry and the best photographer. Okay. So yeah, it was. And that's also, we also have the marketplace, the biggest marketplace for photography related products, camera, lenses, photography service, for example. Even Tokopedia founder Leontinus Alpha Edition admitted that photographer.net at that time was the biggest in Southeast Asia. I worked there for about 1.5 years, first as the project manager for developing the application. I also developed their first mobile application using BlackBerry at that time. I had 5 programmers at that time under my command. 3 of them being hijacked by other companies, 2 by Gameloft, the game developer, 1 by a state-owned company. The other one decided to return to his hometown, getting married and become musician. The other returned to his home, the 5th one, the most senior one, returned to his hometown in Jakarta and become consultant. The company itself, photographer.net, was ceased to exist in 2017 after its founder passed away. Okay, so it still exists now, but it's not a commercial company anymore. It's just a community. It was started as community, and then become commercial company, and then become community again. So that's my first major project. That's my second major. My first major project was management production system for one of the biggest printing company in Indonesia. I was working with Ibu Wiwi at the time to build a production management system. My third biggest project was came later. It's for the Department of Home Affairs, Depdagri. Okay. At the time, the Indonesian President, Pak SBY, he had this poverty eradication program. One of them was called PNPM. So I worked for developing the PNPM. I'm not developing myself, but I was a strength consultant for this project. Okay, I'll tell you. I was hired by Australian government and paid by Australian government as a grant or as a help assistant to the Indonesian government. So I was not working for Indonesian government. I was working for Australian government and paid by them to help Indonesian government developing the system. It's a bit complicated. My third biggest project so far was the electronic procurement system for Indonesian government. And for this project, I was paid by American government program. Okay, so the program was giving Indonesian government $600 million US dollar. It was signed by Pak SBY and Hillary Clinton as the Secretary of State. So 600 million. But my program, the e-procurement, didn't really receive 600. We only received like 50 million. The others are for, if you are familiar now with, preventing stunting in children and also green prosperity, you know, green farming, green energy, things like that. Anyway, I work with the National Procurement Agency. In Indonesia, it's called LKPP. We develop electronic procurement systems. The e-catalog program and also others e-procurement. Okay. I worked there for almost 3 years. And when the contract was up, I decided not to extend my contract, even though they still have 1 year at the time. I decided to stop because I was exhausted from traveling. So at that time, every week, I will teach here Monday to Wednesday, and then on Thursday morning, I will fly to Jakarta and stay there for 2 days and return to Jogja Saturday morning. That traveling really take tolls on my health and also really destroy my, what do you call it? Let me put it this way. Before that jobs, those traveling, every time I went for air travel, whenever I see any airport, I see airplane, I was excited. Okay. After that, it's just, it's really, really killed the buzz of air traveling for me. Anyway, that's my experience. Okay. So why I told you this, because developing information system is not just theoretical, it has to be practical as well. So I did tell you my story because I would like you to know that I knew the practice, I knew the real application because I've been there. Okay, so whatever I told you, whatever I give you exercise, it will be based on real event, not some simulation, not some, you know, case I grab from some books. No, it's based on my own experience. Like the one that you work on for your midterm, that's a real one. That's actually being used for evaluating performance. Okay. I like to do that because it gives you a real taste of whatever happened outside this university. Okay. I don't really like to use the term real world because what we have here is also real. This is not your imagination. You actually paying for this. Okay? And you actually sitting here, not some simulation work. But I like to call it the working world and the thinking world. We think about it here and then you will apply that thinking outside this university. Anyway, okay, so these are the method or the process to develop information system. It's called the system development life cycle. Okay. This is the first methodology for building an information system. Okay. The first formal use of this method or methodology was in the 1970 when the UK government make it compulsory for any companies that want to build system for UK government to use this methodology. Before that, there was no formal methodology, so anyone can build anything. The problem with that was if you are having a developer that has many experience, very clever, you can get good quality system. But with bad developers, cutting corner, and ignoring some steps, you will end up with disasters. Okay, so then the information system community try to develop a way to systematically building information system, and then system development life cycles was born. So it's more than 50 years now, and it is still being taught to any schools. Why? Because it has been tested for 50 years. And a lot of other newer methodology still based on this methodology. It's just an improvement of this methodology rather than completely new. Okay. So what are the steps? First is to analyze. In this stage, you try to find out what kind of system do we need, or even the first question is, do we really need a new information system? I've been dealing with or supervising many students that wrote their thesis on information system development, and they came up with a proposal. And they said that this company or this organization need new information system. My first question is always, do they really need a new information system? Just because something being done manually using pen and paper doesn't necessarily mean it needs something computerized. Okay. So that's the first question. Okay, and then second, if an organization really need a new information system, what kind of information system they need? So that's analysis. And most of the time, 70% of problems of if the information system becoming a problematic, they have mistake, they have bugs, error, all the other problems, 70% of the source of that problem came from improper system analysis. So this part responsible for 70% of the problems. So that's why it's quite critical. They really need to conduct system analysis properly. Okay. Then after they can define what kind of information system they want, it will go to the conceptual design. Conceptual design means you try to create conceptual system that can fulfill the requirements of the users or the organization for that information system. For example, they want to sell their product using mobile application. Right, you design a mobile application. However, because this conceptual design, you don't have to specify what kind of mobile application. The screen size, the technology, for example. Should we use iOS? Should we use Android? Should we use any other, for example? No, it's not the conceptual design. With conceptual design, you'll concentrate on how the process being done. So how the customer will order the product, how the customer will pay their order, how the product will be delivered, for example. Who, what, how will be the question answered by physical design. Like, for example, if you want to develop mobile application, what is your target devices? Smartphone, tablet, iOS, Android? Does it need a certain new technology like this megapixel camera? Does it need this type of screen, for example? That's physical design. And then after the physical design finish, it will go to implementation and conversion. Your design will be implemented. It will be run. It will be tested. It will be delivered to the customer. And then after the system went live, and everything become a routine operation, it will go to operation and maintenance. This is the longest period of all the process. Building the system up to implementation and conversion may take up between 6 months up to probably 18 months. But the operation and maintenance can last maybe 4 or 5 years, depend on the system. Okay. And then it will reach a point where the system that being operated and maintained will be less useful. It's become so old and has to be replaced. And when that point being reached, then the cycle will start again with system analysis for the next new system. And that's why it's called the life cycle, because it's actually like a cycle, starting from analysis, design, implementation, operation, and then return to analysis again. There will be specific course to discuss this subject in more detail, information system analysis and design. Again, I can't remember when will you get that. Okay, so who is involved in the system development life cycles? Many people, many parties, all the stakeholder of a system will have different view, will have different needs, will have different agenda. So building an information system is actually more to non-technical exercise rather than technical one. If it's just programming, coding, building database, and so on and so forth, our neighbor on the east, they can do it fast. So they can probably build an application within like 6 months. However, the non-technical part is the most difficult. Okay, so let's return to my example of the PNPM program with the Ministry of Home Affairs. So PNPM was one of the strategy employed by Pak SBY to eradicate poverty in Indonesia. Okay, he had three prong strategy. First, it's called the giving fish. It means people within poverty, you know the saying that teach, give a man a fish, he could only eat for one day. But teach man a fish to fish, he could feed himself forever. Okay. That's not exactly true. If you don't have much, if you are hungry, if you are not healthy, you can't work. You can't expect somebody within a severe poverty to actually work. They don't have the power, they don't have the resources to actually work. That's why the first strategy is to give these people in this type of poverty something to eat. Okay. So there's rice for the poor, money for the poor, okay? Free healthcare, free schooling for poor students, free healthcare for poor expecting mother, things like that. Okay. So that's the first strategy. The second strategy is to create environment and teach people how to fish. So this is where PNPM come into action. So what PNPM did was every sub-district will get 3 billion rupiah per year directly from the national budget. This 3 billion can be used by this sub-district to build anything or to do anything. For example, if the people in sub-district A, they want to build road that can enable them to transport their rice or whatever they grow to the next town for selling, then they will have the road. They want the money to fix the school. They want the money to build a sanitary facility. It's fine. They can do it. Fix bridge, for example. Yes, they can use that money. Or if they want to spend the money for non-physical activities like training how to create, or to process raw food into packaged food. Courses in small business financial management. Yes, they can use the money for that. So that's the sub-district. And then the World Bank, seeing this program, they say that this is a good program actually, because the development, the empowerment came from the citizen rather than the government. So the government give the money and please do whatever you think you need to do. Okay. So World Bank finally end up financing BNPL. So the process was the government give the money to the sub-district from national budget. The sub-district will spend the money based on the sub-district residents' decision. They will have a meeting to decide that. And then they will create a report, the spend report, on how the money from the government being spent on for what purposes, all the evidence, just like what you did when you become a committee in some activities. And then it will be reported to the national government in Jakarta. And then the government of Indonesia, based on that evidence of spending, will ask the World Bank payment. So we spend this billion or trillion rupiah for BNPM, please pay. Okay. So that's the way. Okay. And it's become so successful that other countries actually learn from Indonesia. I've met consultant from Afghanistan at the time, just being released from Taliban regime. East Timor, so a lot of poor countries try to learn how to empower citizens to develop themselves. Rather, so it's called the CDD, Community Driven Development. So the development, the improvement are driven by community rather than by the government. Okay, so the problem becomes when the Indonesian government realized they need a proper information system, because it will cover the whole Indonesia. Okay. Now, they don't have money. They can't ask for the World Bank for finance, because the World Bank already paid for the program. So the government of Indonesia asking the government of Australia to pay for, you know, to build them some new information system. And the Australian government said, yes, we will help you. So the Australian government fined Indonesian company to build the system. The company actually built something, designed something. And then the problem arise. Why? Because this, all the stakeholder for that system, take place, especially the Ministry of Home Affairs and the World Bank. They come to disagreement that's creating, let's just say everything just stopped because of they could not reach an agreement. So what's the disagreement about? The World Bank insisted that the system only cover up to the sub-district level. Kecamatan. The Ministry of Home Affairs at that time, they sponsored a bill which now become Undang-Undang Desa to the parliament. So they knew that in the future, because of that bill, the program will be on the village level rather than sub-district level. So they, the Ministry of Home Affairs asking for the system to be made to cover village level activities rather than only sub-district activities. So if you look at it from neutral perspective, both are right. The World Bank said that it should be on sub-district level because that's the regulation at that time. Ministry of Affairs want the system to cover village level activities because that's the future. Okay, so they anticipate that. And they come to a deadlock. The deadlock was running for a few months until the Australian government, through their donor organization, AusAid, reached for me. It's actually one of my friends. He called me one day and saying that, hey, do you want a job? You want side job? And I said, yes, why not? So let's come to Jakarta. So I went to Jakarta, meet with the teams, being interviewed by different peoples. And I was accepted as the quality assurance. That's my official title. But my actual work was to reconcile those stakeholders that have differences in view. So the technical solution for the disagreement between Indonesian government and World Bank is quite simple. It's just like what you always did or what everybody did with application in your mobile or your tablet. If you had free version, you will have advertising and also you can only play or game, for example, up to this level. But if you want more, pay. You won't get any advertising and you can reach higher level. So that's the strategy that I. So the developer will build the system up to village level. But when presented or being delivered to the Indonesian government, it will be locked to sub-district level. Only after the Undang-Undang Desa become official bill, the village level will be unlocked. And they already give the unlocking key. So the technical solution is simple. Nothing miraculous. Everybody can do it. But the problem is just how to solve the differences. Okay. Let me give you. So this part, I will not cover this part in many detail because you will meet this part later in information system management course, okay, planning. We will discuss this in much more detail. Okay, the behavior. Okay. The problem with the disagreement was poor communication. So I have to attend so many meetings. The first time I worked for the Australian the AusAid, at that time, I spent a week in Jakarta just to go from one meeting to another, talking to one people to another. Okay. And I learned that you need formal communication, like, you know, formal meeting, formal letter, but you also need informal communication, having light discussion during lunch, coffee breaks. Sometimes when we have to go from one place to another, we share a taxi cab and we have discussion in that taxi cab. Not to be, you know, fraudulent or anything like that negatively, but with informal discussion, the other parties usually will be more open and more flexible, willing to listen. Because in informal forums like formal meeting, they have to stick to their institution agenda. Their boss is watching, so they have to, you know, do properly. But behind the scene, we can reach an agreement, and then we'll try to convey that agreement to the bosses. So yeah, communication. That's the key. Okay. So that's what actually I did. I, I was feeling like a firefighter, you know, putting off fire everything everywhere. But yeah, that's really a good time. So before we continue to the behavior, in any organization there will be a lot of system need to be built. For Atmajaya, for example, you already have experience with academic system, our learning management system, Microsoft Teams. You have Siatma. But behind the scenes, there are other systems that also being used. For example, for payroll, reporting system to the government, which is quite complicated. Quality control system, academic system, and so on and so forth. So there are many systems needs to be built, but the organization usually only have limited resources and time to build the system. So they need to have some kind of prioritization. Which system need to be built first and why? Okay. So system A, it's critical, need to be built now. System B, less critical, maybe at the end of the years. The other system is less critical, so maybe next year or not at all. Okay. And then another selection after that is to have feasibility analysis. Does the proposed system feasible? Feasibility analysis will cover or be seen from different aspects. For example, the first one, and this is the most important, I think, is the economic. Do the benefit of new system justify the cost? In simpler world, does the benefit bigger than the cost? If the answer is yes, it does, then go on. But if the answer is no, it does not, the cost is bigger than the benefit, then stop. Don't do it. Any action, any decision in any organization should have bigger benefit compared to cost. Technical, can we use existing technology or should we buy new technology, or in case of IT company like Google's or Facebook, Netflix, they need to invent new technology to solve their business problem. Like when Netflix try to stream movie to our devices, they found tremendous difficulties. They have to figuring out how to stream movie from their servers to our devices seamlessly. And they create some of the technology for that. Google, they create technology to handle search data that can be used for advertising. Facebook, when Facebook started to expand their data centers, they need almost 1,000 new servers every day. And the existing companies like Hewlett Packard, Dell, Oracle, they could not build those kind of servers with Facebook budget. It means it has to be cheap because branded servers are expensive. So what happened was Facebook actually developed their own server. They create their own servers, they create the design of their own servers with their technology, and then make that design open. So Facebook now has a website called the Open Computing Initiative. So if you have a need for designing brandless servers that can perform just as good as Facebook servers, then you can copy their design. Okay. That's technical issue. Legal issue, does a new system comply with regulation, laws, or contractual obligation? For example, if you creating application to calculate income tax, have you comply with the income tax regulation, how to calculate income tax, the tariffs for income tax, things like that. Scheduling. Can the system be developed in time allotted? For example, if you estimate that the system will be built in 18 months, will it be possible to build the system in 18 months? Do we have the resources for 18 months? Operational. Do we have the people to design and implement the system? Will people use the new system? With the software for system for PNPM, the original design was for internet-based or online system. So people just need to enter the data into their laptops. It will be updated to Jakarta. But the problem when the developer actually goes around Indonesia for a survey, they found, for example, in rural Kalimantan and Papua, there was no mobile connection. There is none. Sorry, there was none. I don't know whether now it has improved or not, but there was none. So it's impossible. Okay. Then the government said at that time, every sub-district will have internet. That was the SBY program also. There will be internet in every sub-district or kecamatan. It's called big program internet kecamatan. And yes, it was. The problem is in Java, for example, here, if you want to go to sub-district offices, it's just around the corner here. But in rural Papua, it will take a week on foot just to reach the next village, let alone to go to sub-district office. And that's a normal day. If the weather or the security issues arise, then it could be longer. So that's not feasible operationally to have online system using the internet at the time. So this is 2013 in rural Papua or Kalimantan or even Sumatra. So we have to design differently. Capital budgeting, this is to calculate the financial benefit and cost. Again, I will not touch this because you will learn this on financial management. And I'm not expert in this. Now, behavioral problem. People tend to resist if there's something new. Some people have low resistance, others have high resistance, especially with technology. Once you introduce technology, you will change the environment. You will change the community. For example, in my youth, it's funny I can say that my youth, when I was in college, every time we close to a holiday, big holiday like Christmas or Idul Fitri, people will, you know, buy greeting cards, holiday cards, build them or sometimes even make them themselves and send it to their family, relatives, or friends, most of them. When the mobile phone arrived, the cards being replaced by text messages, some older people see this as impolite. But, you know, that's technology. Nowadays, not only is just text message, but sometimes you just reuse some text from other people, change a bit, and then broadcast that message to your relatives. Well, that's the way it is. So, you like it or not, that's the norm. Okay. So, it will always create disruption. And it's not just high technology like smartphone. When the city of Depok was built, the government built a highway between Depok and Jakarta. It's now called this as Lenteng Agung Highway. In the middle of that two roads, one to Jakarta and one to Depok, there was a train, rail. Okay. Railway for trains. So when they develop the highway, it changes the small village road into a wide highway intercity road where cars and motorcycle passing through in high speed. In the early days, there were a lot of village residents being hit by the traffic. Why? Because it was the custom previously when they crossed the road, they didn't actually looking left or right for incoming traffic. They just crossed the road because it was a village road. But then when they changed the road into highway, they still having the same habit as before, crossing the road without looking at the incoming traffic. That's why there was a lot of accident. So that's introducing new technology, a highway into a village. And that's disrupt the life. Okay. So we need to deal with it. One thing to overcome this behavioral problem is usually communication and education. To communicate what are the changes being introduced, don't worry about the changes, so on and so forth, and educate the stakeholder on what's to expect from the new system, what can be done from the new system, what's the improvement, and what's the limitation of the new system. So manage expectation. That's the behavior. And also to prevent behavioral problem, we need management support. When we developed the system for the Ministry of Home Affairs, PNBM, the director of PNBM actually very supportive of this project. When we met with the users for a conference, we spent like 3 days, 2 nights in Bandung for this Spartan meeting. So we meet with the users and we discuss, we present the system and they try the system and then they give us inputs, correction, or any other things that they think can improve the system. And this director, his name was Kun, actually attending all those meetings. We spent nights attending the discussion and sometimes interfere when some things that he felt it's a bit off the track. For example, we had a heated discussion with some of the element of World Bank. This guy, an American guy, insists that we use Oracle technology or branded technology, not open source. This become difficult because the government of Indonesia insists, well, it's not only insists, Indonesian government have regulation that require all government agency to use open source technology. So Pak Kun was cutting off the debate and said to that World Bank guy, look, what you propose is a very good solution. It's just like the Mercedes of cars. So fancy, luxurious, and nobody can argue that was the best car in the world. However, what we need is a truck for carrying sand. Do you want to carry sand with your fancy Mercedes cars? So yeah, that's because he supported development and he willing to spend time to attend the discussion, actually guiding. Every time I met him, he always called me, you know, with Japanese mas, please do the best. He always said that. Okay. And he understand. He actually understand what's the problem. He understand the process. He understands the system development. That's really encouraging. So whenever he attend the meeting between all the stakeholders, it gives us easier way to, you know, it make life of the developer easy because of him. Unfortunately, just before the system being finalized and handed over to the Indonesian government, he passed away. His replacement was not that keen on, you know, the new system, so I don't know what happened. I moved to another project at the time. That's it for today. Any question? No? Okay. Now, your final exam, it will related to system analysis and design. But don't worry, I will not ask you to design a system. Not yet. Okay. Maybe if you enroll in information system analysis and design course later during your course of study, and I'm your lecturer, then yes, at that time I'll give you assignment to build systems, but not for this course. Okay. But I will take some element of what I already give you, and I will give you the topics in the next few weeks, and you can use that for the exam. I'll give you more detail because I'm still, you know, developing the exam questions, exam problems, but I'll give you the more details in the coming weeks. Okay. Any questions? No? Okay. That's it for today. Thank you for attending the lectures, and for you too, Stefania. Get well soon and see you next week.
Thank you, sir.
No worries.
Thank you, sir.